And you might think about what those are. And here's a good example. I use this in Love's Confusion, but I think it's a really good example. So, you know, love, genuine love, motivates you to do all kinds of things that are not scripted. So when we're scripted, you know, we're thinking of chocolates and roses, day, you know, dinner dates and other kinds of things that sort of are the normal language to show, you know, I'm kind of interested in you, I'd like to date you, right? Whatever those signs are, right, that our culture says, this is what you do when you want to indicate to somebody that you want to date them. But when you actually love someone, you're inspired to do all kinds of things that are not part of the script at all. The example I give is, you know, wanting to lick the marmalade out of the corner of the other person's mouth. It's not a kind of thing that's anywhere in the script, and yet affection and love for somebody can make you want to do little things like that you wouldn't otherwise want to do. They're not in your will. You're not thinking, you know what I'm going to do to show that I love this person? Is next time we're having breakfast together, I'm going to... All right, you don't think that. It's just that you're motivated. And that's sort of, there's a kind of clarity about the fact that it's spontaneous that signals real affection. So, anyway, that's to put a whole big load of other stuff on the blackboard. And you'll see that Plato is tracking, well, I hope we'll see that he's tracking, almost all of these ideas. The other one, very easy to leave out, and it came up with the thought about children, right? And we looked at it just at the end of last class. It's very easy. It shows how readily we have accepted a series of disconnects that used to be hardwired in. So here's the thought. What has love got to do with reproduction? So we've got our concept of love, and now we're looking at all the different kinds of things we can ask and think about it, and now we've got a connection in this concept, right? What do we need the concept for? What is its definition? And the thought would be, is reproduction anywhere in there? Well, once upon a time, we would have thought this way, right? Well, reproduction is part of the picture, right? So, you know the song? Love and marriage, and marriage, they go together. Why do they go? Dad was told by mother, you can't have one without the other. What does that sound like? You want sex? First we get married. Why? Well, Oliver Goldsmith tells us why, right? The costs to you of the woman of getting pregnant outside marriage, before we didn't have that insidious double standard, were extremely high. So mother had a very good reason to say you can't have one without the other, whereas dad did not have that reason, right? And that showed us something, right? Love, marriage, children formed a natural kind of connection in the minds of even popular songwriters. They could kind of rely on it without anybody saying, hey, what do you mean? Right? Why do love and marriage go together? Why does mom say you can't have one without the other? Those questions didn't arise. Everybody found it completely natural to think that way. So what happened? What happened then? So Freud was the first one really to see that the reproduction and the sexual aim, as he put it, were only soldered together. It wasn't a conceptual connection. They were simply put together by a kind of natural bond, right? In the way that, in the animal kingdom, sex and reproduction go hand in hand, right? We don't have, human females don't go into periods when they're estrous. Well, they do, but it's different from animal estrous, where there's a season of going into heat. And outside that season, there's no sex. It's just no sexual activity. It's only in the period of heat. Right? Imagine what our social life would be like if that were true. So most of the time, sex wouldn't be on her horizon at all. sort of males and females would hang out together that show no interest in what doing anything with one another at all until, bang, that's all they were interested in. So watch a bunch of male dogs come around a house where there's a bitch and heat, and they're all just, they don't know why they're there, but they can't leave. Right? And our lives will be very different. So in us, right, the first thing was the separation of getting rid of estrusness, so that was no longer the way we sexual life occurs. That itself is an interesting story of how it happened, right, and why, and what the theories are about it is not so we fully understand them, but it's a very good question. And now the next one is, okay, so once those are separated, it's still the case, right, that pregnancy or reproduction and sex are naturally put together. So if you don't know how it is, where you are in your menstrual cycle, don't know how to tell when you're ovulating, and of course for ages nobody knew how to do that, right? You couldn't be confident that you wouldn't get pregnant if you had sex. So effectively the two were still together. Then we discovered, part of the discovery is effective methods. Understanding this, how we got pregnant, people got pregnant, we found a way to split off the sexual activity from the pregnancy. This could just be prophylactics, right? Or, right, then the birth control pill. And now, effectively, sexual activity and reproduction are separated. You have to, unless you're ignorant of all of that, but knowing all of this, right, you now can arrange it that you will never get pregnant, no matter how or when you have sex, if you're a woman. And that's a huge change, right? Because what's happened is sex and reproduction have been pulled apart by an intrusion into what used to be a natural unity of a sort, but that, as Freud says, they're only contingently put together. The sexual aim and the reproductive aim, he thought, were separate anyway. Its nature kind of, as you said, incentivized us to reproduce by putting the sexual aim, right, in such a place that if we tried to achieve it, we'd end up reproducing. That was the way Freud thought about it. We were able to effectively separate them with birth control. Here's the question, though. When we did that, when we separated them, what did we do to the concept? So is it this, that we took what was at the conceptual level a kind of natural unity and we disfigured it by subtracting something from it? Was that never part of it at all, but just an artificial fact of our ignorance about reproduction? So that's a very good question. You see that Plato thinks that reproduction is central to the concept. But reproduction is not what we think it is. So reproduction is there, but there are lots of different kinds of reproduction. And then it won't be quite so obvious that what we think of reproduction is central. But nonetheless, there'll be a kind of reproduction. It's as if a shadow of reproduction was left behind in the concept even after we did this change. And that shadow still has more substance than we're inclined to think, just because we've separated off love from and sex from actual reproducing the species. Okay, that's the methodological addition that I wanted to make to last time's discussion. Any questions or issues that anybody wants to raise about that? Thoughts, reactions? None of the, I'm not claiming any of this as, you know, will withstand all of the final scrutiny we'll bring on. It's just that we need to have it kind of roughly in place to alert us to signal various things we want to think about, even if in the end we want to criticize them. Okay? Yeah?
Could you possibly talk more about what we need the concept for?
Yeah. So first to get on your radar, the fact that that's a very good question, right? What do we need the concept for anyway? And so think of, say,
a feminist arguing that our concept of romantic love is one that we absolutely don't need. It's actually going to end up, if you utilize it, exploiting women. Right? The thought is, get rid of it. It's part of patriarchy. It's part of a political arrangement, a power arrangement, that we really ought to be committed to destroying. What would we put in its place then? We'd be asking, right, if anything. So maybe it's just something we don't want part of our lives at all. But let's suppose that's not so. It was a degenerate or debased, you know, politically contaminated version of something that we do want. We want that, but without the power differential, right? We want it without there being any hegemonic influence. Right? That's what we want up there. Then the next question would be, okay, what do we want that for? Or what is that doing for us? Even if we kind of purify and get it so that it's not politically suspect. And my thought is that we want it to do two things for us, right, at least. One has to do with anxiety, and the other has to do with compulsion or power. So even if there's no hegemony, right, it's not as if males dominated women and the political system is bound to end up exploiting women. It's rather that, that's, even if I change that, that's not going to change individual people from utilizing power to exploit one another. Right? It may be that males now enjoy no privilege as a gender or sex, but I do. Right? Not because I'm a male, but just to happen to be your boss. Right? That's still going to be an issue when it comes to my requesting a date or sexual favors, when you have to worry about what the consequences will be if you turn them down. Even if we did away with the domination of women in general by men in general, and it could go the other way around. You could be the boss and I could be the employee and you could demand this and I would have to make the calculation. So I think one is that love is not something that you can coerce. You can't make somebody love you. You can't make yourself love somebody. That gives it a very special connection and role in relationship. And the other is that the loving eye seems to be the one that we're willing to disclose to. So I think if you just have to give yourself some couple of examples, right? Things that you would tell somebody that you knew loved you, that you wouldn't dream of telling anybody else. And that doesn't mean you'll tell everything. Some people are such that, and this is, I have to think, I'll take another step. Suppose you think that love is an ideal of relationship between individuals, and is therefore itself as individualized as the individuals who utilize it. So A's love for B and C's love for D will have some things in common, but they won't be exactly the same. Those would be the thought that love is not something we want to buy off the shelf, right? We don't want a one-size-fits-all. What my love for someone is and what your love for someone else may be quite different, even though we'll still be able to say those are love, right? So here's the kind of thought I would have. So if you pick something like this, you're willing to disclose. You're willing to disclose to your lover. There's an area of intimacy where you're revealing. It might be that, in fact, you're the kind of person who can only love somebody who doesn't demand that kind of disclosure. Right? So you feel that's a threat, an intrusion from anyone, no matter how kindly disposed they are. You're too protective of a kind of inner privacy that any attempt to get in there is going to set off alarm bells. So you're the kind of person that can only be loved by someone who doesn't need that or doesn't expect it. And so when I try to put on the repertoire of what the recipe, sort of what love is, I'm going to have to individualize it, because even something like this, for someone who thinks that they're not lovable, and therefore who thinks that anyone who tries to love them is not worth being in a relationship with because it's obvious their values are crazy since they love somebody who is not lovable, you're going to have your work cut out for you to have a good relationship with that person, right? It's not that it's impossible. It's just that you have to craft what you're going to do quite differently. And then you ask yourself this, well, what am I aiming at when I do all this crafting? And you want to say, well, you're aiming at loving that person. But what you're discovering is that it can't take all the standard forms. So that's a way to think that what we want in an ideal of a relationship is something that's minted in coins that are as small as our psychologies and our individuality. Because we don't want generalized love. We want the love that fits me, is what I want. And I wouldn't recognize even as love something that didn't see that, right? So that's a problem that lovers run into regularly, is that one thinks of loving as one thing, and the other thinks of it as something else. And when the two meet, it turns out that one feels unloved, even though the other is busy doing everything he or she thinks loving is going to be. So if we're thinking that way, this is the area in our private lives or individual lives where our ideal of relationship is not one that we can generalize in the way we can when we talk about citizens all enjoying equal rights or anything like that. It's really something different. Well, I don't know that, not absolutely sure that's the way it should go, but that's what I'm inclined to push towards, that we want ideals of love that are like that. And those are bound to be tied to larger ideals of how we think men and women, men and men and women, and parents and children and all the other things should live together. As any form of social or political life that we imagine that it permits or allows power influences, right, of the bad sort, so to speak, distorted communications that are distorted by the power structure, that's going to be one in which that's going to affect what love is in that society. Right. That's the thought. So, you know, if you think about the way that a capitalist economy influences how we think about each other, that's just a crude way of saying, what is interior capitalism? Because that's going to affect what I think my well-being is and what I think it is for you to do something for me, right? Compared to a world that's not like. So our individual ideals and our political ideals go together, but they're not the same. Because our political ideals are about our public life. Our erotic ideals and our ideals about love are about our intimate, individual, personal lives. And a big part of good thinking about politics is we don't want the sphere of politics to permeate all the other spheres too much. Right? We want an area that's separated from somewhat separated from or hived off a bit from political intrusion. Okay? Yeah.
I guess a more specific question about the inability to compel love.
Yeah.
What about something like Stockholm Syndrome? Would that be not real compulsion or not real love?
That's an interesting question. I mean, of course, there are all kinds of pathologies that we recognize, and the other person is brought into a condition, which even they would describe as a loving one, by means that make us suspect that that's not so. So an obvious case is when somebody joins a cult, for example, or a cult leader. And again, it just shows that when we're trying to think about this, right, we're thinking about something that has lots of ramifications. So how it is you came to be in the condition you're in relative to another person tells us a lot about how we're going to understand that condition. Yeah, so the thought would be, it's a bit like, is there genuine courage exhibited in a bad war, a war for bad ends. So this is a problem that arose very strongly about the Vietnam War. Right? Should the Purple Heart and so on, the people won in the Vietnam, be taken away because the war itself was, in some sense, let's call it an immoral war, raises exactly the same question. So you might think, no, it's genuine bravery, and they should get those medals. But we want to make another judgment about it, which is it's not the best kind of bravery, right? Because it satisfies a bad end. And now we want to say about this, yeah, maybe it is love, but it's not, it's failing along one dimension to measure up to all of the standards. Unless there are more questions, why don't we take a break for 5 minutes or so? I want to